Good morning. It's my privilege to be with you again this morning for our diversions. In New Zealand, there is a reptile that looks like a lizard, and it is called a tuatara. Physically, it looks almost like a chameleon, but that's in appearance only. Zoologically, it is from a different lineage to lizards, and that lineage places it in the order of Rhynchocephalia. It's almost unpronounceable, isn't it? Rhynchocephalia. When I saw the word written, I didn't have a clue how to say it, and I had to consult Google. Tuatara is an easier word to say, and it's a Maori word, meaning peaks on the back. That's understandable, because along the ridge of the back of this reptile is a row of pointed peaks. And the tuatara, or to give it its zoological name, Spinodon punctatus, is the only surviving Rhynchocephalia in the world. All the other species of that order are known only as fossils. They are extinct. And it really looks prehistoric. But there are an estimated 100,000 of them thriving on various islands in New Zealand, particularly on two islands in the Cook Strait between the North and South Island. And they are really living fossils. In a different devotion, I spoke about the woolly mammoths, which were thought to have died out 11,000 years ago, until fossils were found on St. Paul Island in Alaska and Wrangel Island in the Arctic that were only 4,000 or 5,000 years old. And we are more familiar with the coelacanth, because that comes from South Africa, the story, the discovery of the coelacanth. It was thought to be extinct. It was thought to have become extinct 60 million years ago. Now, how they come up with these dates, I don't know. But 60 million years, they say. Until in 1938, a fisherman took a strange fish from his fishing nets to Marjorie Courtney Latimer, curator of the museum in East London, South Africa, who sent for Professor J.L.B. Smith, Professor of Ichthyology at Rhodes University. And he came to East London and he confirmed the identification. A coelacanth, extinct for 60 million years, and here it is, a coelacanth. It wasn't alive, but it was identified, and it had been alive. And there have been more recent catches of the coelacanth, so they are out there. Be careful when you go fishing. Now, in a way, Elijah thought he was the only prophet of God left. He thought that the prophets of God had become extinct. Not a type of lizard or fish or mammoth, a prophet of God. There was a conflict, you see, there was a conflict going on and between the prophets of Baal and the prophets of God, and they were killing each other. Jezebel was the queen, and she was killing the prophets of the Lord. And so we read in 1 Kings chapter 18, and starting at verse 15, Elijah says, "As the Lord Almighty lives, whom I serve, I will surely present myself to King Ahab today." And so Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him, and Ahab went to meet Elijah. And when he saw Elijah, he said to him, "Is that you, you troubler of Israel?" I have not made trouble for Israel, Elijah replied. But you and your father's family have. You have abandoned the Lord's commands and have followed the Baals. Now summon the people from all over Israel to meet me on Mount Carmel. Bring the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table. And so he sent word throughout all of Israel. The prophets assembled on Mount Carmel. Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him." But the people said nothing. And then Elijah said to them, "I am the only one of the Lord's prophets left. But Baal has 450 prophets. Get two bulls for us. Let Baal's prophets choose one for themselves and let them cut it in pieces and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. And I will prepare the other bull and put it on the wood and set fire to it. And not set fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord, and we'll see who answers by fire, and he is God." And you know how that story went on, or you probably do, that the test was done, that the prophets of Baal did everything they could to have their gods answer with fire. And they didn't. And then Elijah poured water on his and did everything to stop God from answering with fire. And when he called on God to answer with fire, God sent fire, and even the stones of the altar were consumed. Well, after that, Elijah flees for his life. He's afraid that Ahab, and more particularly Jezebel, will kill him, and he hides away. And we find that he's hiding away from God, and God tries to speak to him through the storm and through the various ways. And eventually God does speak to him. And this is what God says to him in the next chapter, in chapter 19 and verse 9. He says there, "And the word of the Lord came to him, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?' He replied, 'I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, put your prophets to death, and with the sword. And I am the only one left. I am the only one left. And now they are trying to kill me too.'" And do you sometimes feel like that? Do you sometimes feel that you are the only one left? Everybody has abandoned you. You are living in an unbelieving family or community. You're moving with an unbelieving group of friends. And all that you believe is being challenged. The things that you have applied and learnt and valued in your life are being broken down. And you feel alone and maybe a little fearsome. You may be in a horrible work environment. You may be exposed to corruption in society. Whatever the pressures are, and you feel alone. Now, Elijah was sent back to anoint King Hazael over Aram and King Jehu over Israel. And he was sent back to commission Elisha as a prophet. And God tells Elijah, he says, "I have reserved 7,000 in Israel who have not bowed down to Baal." He certainly wasn't alone. God had his faithful. God had those that were going to form a new surge in belief and faith in God, who were going to face the prophets of Baal and Asherah. And there are two reasons that you are not alone. There are two reasons that you can't feel abandoned. The first is that there's a fellowship of believers. The church is there for you. Let us gather around you and support you, because without the support of other believers, without the fellowship of the faithful, you surely will become extinct as a believer. And so there's that fellowship of believers. The second one is the promises that Jesus makes. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I am with you till the end. And he tells David in Psalm 23, David writes and he says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you are with me. In that darkest hour, in that darkest time, Jesus is walking with us. And whatever your challenges are today, whatever your despair is today, know this, that Jesus is there and he loves you, and nothing can separate you from his love. And so God bless you as you trust him. And please get into fellowship. Get some believers praying for you. And know that God is good all of the time. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to you. No, we're not extinct. We're not extinct. You have an eternal future for each one of us. We will live forever because of faith in Jesus Christ. And as we come to you today, I pray for those who are despairing of that eternal life, who are despairing and saying, it's not like that. I have doubts, I have fears, I have pressures, I have challenges to my faith, I have terrible people who are talking about me and talking to me, and I'm the only one left. It's nobody good. And you tell us that's not so. For Elijah, there were 7,000 prophets who had not bent their knee to Baal. For us, there are many, many people who would love us and embrace us and take us into the fellowship of believers, that together we will stand. And so, Lord Jesus, I pray for each one out there who today may be going through trials, bring him into that love which can only be found in you, in that peace. We ask it in your name. Amen. Days.